How's it going, everyone? I hope you're having a wonderful day. This video here is going to be a kind of masterclass on forward-facing sonar, specifically targeted towards those of you who fish Garmin LiveScope or are considering Garmin LiveScope. Now, I'm not paid by Garmin. I don't make any money selling graphs, none of that. This is my expert opinion. I say expert. This is my opinion about forward-facing sonar, how to specifically target fish. Maybe you've been on the water several times, maybe you've just got LiveScope and you're not having as much success as you think you should, or you see people on tour in the Bass Pro Tour or Bassmasters, and you see them having a lot of success with it, but you can't replicate that success on your bodies of water. So hopefully this video is going to serve a couple different purposes, not just divulging into what you see on the graph, but also how to present your baits in certain manners and also react to how the fish are reacting to your baits. I'm gonna go through a lot of the ins and outs of LiveScope, whether it's, you know, drawing up situations on the graph here or explaining cone angle and all of the really more scientific parts of fishing with forward-facing sonar. Of course, I'm gonna also be talking about certain baits that work most times of the year, as well as my go-to presentations and how I like to present these baits. I'm also gonna be having LiveScope footage that I've got off my own graph. I personally use an Echomap Ultra. This is the old Echomap Ultra. It's a 12-inch, as well as some of the videos are gonna be 32, some of them are 34. 34 is just a little bit clearer far out, but the picture is going to be very, very similar. All the stuff you're gonna be looking at is going to be off an Echomap Ultra model. It does, I think, technically have a higher resolution count, but the images are going to look very, very similar. So let's go ahead and just dive into what you see on the graph. When you first get your graph, or if you've already kind of gotten into your graph, you're gonna be very familiar, hopefully, with all the different settings. And there's a lot of different settings in there. You've got your gain, you've got your color gain, you've got your color limit, you've got different color palettes, you've got the bars running down your grid layout. There's a lot of different settings in there. Let's just pretend for right now that you're running it stock. I take the grid overlay off, and I also do a couple things to my depth and also my range. So your gain is going to be your main sensitivity. Typically, I like to run mine anywhere from around 67 to 75. Those are gonna be kind of the main areas I like to focus on, even without touching my color gain or color limit. Most of the time, I'm going to be running my range, which is my forward range, out around 75 all the way up to 100. It really just depends what type of water I'm fishing. It depends how deep I am. When it comes to depth though, this is also very important. This is something that a lot of people miss out on. I'm actually gonna redraw this because this isn't very accurate of how I like to set my graph up. I always like to have the bottom off the actual bottom of the graph. So you're probably thinking that, Sam, you're getting rid of all this usable graph space. That is correct. However, most of the time, I like to see what the full bottom content is. And if there is a depth change somewhere in here, I'm not gonna be able to see it if my range is all the way off, off on the bottom here. So I'm able to see slight depth changes. I'm able to see fish cruising on the bottom. Here in Texas, most of the areas that I'm fishing are gonna be very, very steep breaks, or it's just gonna be pretty flat. If you're fishing up north, you've got a lot cleaner water, you've got deeper water, possibly having it go all the way down to, let's say, around 40 foot maximum isn't a bad thing, because a lot of the times the fish don't get that super deep. They're usually suspended up in here. But regionally, let's just focus on, I guess, average water. For this situation here, I think I'm gonna set my depth, let's just say around 20 to 40. So that's my range for my depth. My range for my forward facing looking out is gonna be, like I said, around 70 to around 100, really just depends. And with that, I'm really able to scale what I'm looking at. A lot of the fish look the exact same. I'm able to say, all right, look, I'm in, let's, for example, use 10 foot of water. I'm looking in 10 foot of water right here. I know this fish takes up basically a foot of screen. That's a pretty big fish relative. So as you're going through LiveScope and forward-facing sonar, it really helps to be able to visualize. And this is one thing I'm definitely going to focus on. This is going to be a longer video just because I want to divulge a lot of the information that you are able to translate on your graph, and that hopefully I am just accelerating that process. Everything I think of in scale, I think of it in a 3D model, and that's one of the great things that I want to start off on here. The Garmin LiveScope has a bigger cone angle than a Humminbird MegaLive or an active target system. So your cone angle on a Garmin really allows you to see in the 3D sense that you have more information you're gathering from a specific cone. So you're able to see the left side of the fish or the right side of the fish. You're able to really hyper-locate and pinpoint on a fish. So let me explain the cone angle real quick. I think the cone angle on a Garmin is either 15 or 18 in active targets, a little bit more than that. But that little bit can make a big difference. It can be, you know, 6 to 10 foot of variance depending on how far you're looking out. So with LiveScope, yes, I will say you can definitely get off your mark a lot easier, but it allows you to really get a lot more information at the far end of your screen. So with the cone angles here, the great thing about the Garmin, like I said, you're able to divulge a lot more information. Thinking of it on a one-dimensional scale here, I guess a two-dimensional scale, if you're looking straight out, you know, with this situation here, looking straight out towards this brush pile, you're gonna be able to see that brush pile. And in a one-dimensional, two-dimensional manner, you're able to see that brush pile, and it is going to be one singular color. However, with Garmin LiveScope, all their color palettes, or almost all their color palettes, are in a like a color scheme effect. So amber, which is the default setting, you're able to see shades of white, yellow, orange, and red. And that's one of my favorite ones because the red really stands out against a dark background. The white is going to be a very dense object. So typically when I see a fish, they're going to be around that yellow color scheme. So for the fish here, it's green on the graph. Think of it as a color scheme, basically. So white's being the hardest and red's going to be very, very soft. So typically here in Texas, if I'm fishing around soft bottom, the bottom's gonna look a little red. If I'm fishing a brush pile, which is generally wood or artificial something like concrete, something like that, it's going to be almost like a white slash orange color. When it's a fish, it's gonna be around that yellow color, white color as well. Now going back to thinking more three-dimensional here, if I am not directly on that fish, let's say if I'm looking directly on that fish, perfectly lined up with it, it's going to be a very, very bright return. If I get left or right of that fish, it is going to be a lesser return. And I'm gonna show a little clip here, overlay it on here, and you're gonna see my A-rig is not in frame perfectly. You can see it's a duller red, it's not as vibrant, but you can see those fish are extremely vibrant. This is one key approach, this is one technique I use to really gauge if I am on target. Now, as you go through the year, the fish are gonna start moving more and more. A lot of the time when I'm live scoping specifically, these fish aren't moving a ton. These fish are sitting on this little channel drop and I am able to throw my lure out there, kind of track it down. Even though I'm probably off 3 or 4 foot, I'm still able to see it just because that cone angle is much bigger. And I know I'm off, but I also know I'm drifting. So as my boat drifts down, the A-rig's gonna get pulled to the side and I was able to marry all that information up. So there's a lot of different layers to this. So here we go. Let's take a look at this scenario here. This is a top 2D model on the bottom. I've got the boat. I've got what I'm looking at, it's the brush pile, and you see a fish here. So this is the 2D model. This is what I want you to really think about as you're looking at your screen, because you're up here. The great thing about forward-facing sonar is it gives you lots of information, like I said, depth and range to your target. So this is what you're looking at in a three-dimensional scale. You're taking a slice out of the water, essentially, and looking at it on a screen. So if you can visualize that, you're looking through the water, that's probably the easiest way to explain it. It's very hard to wrap my head around it sometimes. Technology has come such a long way. But on a two-dimensional, think of this like a side scan. This is basically shooting out your transducer beam. And if this was side scan, this fish here, you can see, let's call this 5 foot off the bottom, 4 foot off the bottom on this brush pile. You're gonna see what side scan would do is it's gonna add a shadow right behind it like that. And good side scanners back in the day were able to calculate this distance between the shadow and the fish signature, which on a hummingbird, which I grew up with kinda, this would be a white dot typically, and this would be the black dot. So you got your rice grain and you got your shadow. This is almost the same thing. You're still gonna see the fish on LiveScope. You're just not really gonna see the shadow a lot of the time just because you're shooting out and it doesn't really pick up shadows that way. So one thing I really want to key in on is keep your foot on the trolling motor. This is one of the biggest tips I can give. This is one of the biggest tips Josh Jones can give. This is one of the biggest tips that if you live scope already, you know how important it is to keep your foot on the trolling motor. Why is it so important? Well, when you take your foot off the trolling motor, several different factors can occur. Your boat can drift, your boat can turn, the fish can move. There's a lot of moving parts here. If you can keep your foot on the trolling motor and actively track that fish by using your foot, or if it's on a turret system and you're spot locked, this is going to give you the most control. You're able to know if that fish is moving left to right, like this, left to right, and you can also tell on forward facing sonar if it's coming towards you or away from you. So you're able to almost three-dimensionally tell on the screen if you're able to track your foot placement. A lot of people don't have those fine motor skills to be able to do that. It all comes with time on the water. If you're able to track fish when they're not moving and you're moving, it is much easier to start with that. If you're both not moving, like you're anchored down or something, it is probably the easiest, right? When it gets hard is when you're in 3 foot waves, the fish are just feeding up on bait, chasing everywhere. That's when it becomes hard. And that's the reason why I wanted to put this video out here really during the summertime, because this is what we are stuck with at the moment. A lot of these fish are gonna be moving around. Some of them, like this fish here, stuck down on a brush pile, and it makes it very, very easy to target these fish, especially when they're locked down on certain cover, feeding around whatever cover structure they're on, whether it's a rock pile, whether it's, of course, a brush pile, a tree, you can see these fish on LiveScope. So let's talk about bait presentation. Obviously, I just talked about how the fish set up on a piece of cover and how we can track them that way. Let's talk about bait presentation. So as we talked about already, fish will put out different signatures depending on how big they are. And this is going to be the same principle I take with my baits. So let's break down my top winter baits, right? First off, one of the easiest baits to get bit on during the winter time when they're not moving as much, when they are very susceptible to being caught, is an Alabama rig. Now, not this one specifically, but what's great about this one is it shows you just how big it is. You know, it's as wide as my hand. There are several other ones out there which are bigger. This is just the Strike King Titanium one. This is also a great A-rig to use. Not pushing them super heavily. I personally use the Shane's Baits, Mini Blades of Glory, the Dominator, something like that. So what's great about this is it's such a big presence in the water. It's very wide. It puts off a lot of flash and it also puts off a lot of disturbance. I've done another video in the past where I talked about bait presence. The A-rig has a lot of bait presence because it has, well, 5 different baits on there plus blades. So it is moving a lot of water. It is very wide and you should be able to see it on your forward facing sonar extremely, extremely easy. So going back to the video I talked about earlier, showing that A-rig falling down, you can see that A-rig's not a small A-rig. I was using the Shane's Baits Dominator on that one, I believe, and you can see those fish are just as big, just as tall as that A-rig. So bait presentation is one of the biggest keys I like to talk about because this can make or break your fishing day. Sometimes fish are just extremely dumb, but sometimes they are extremely smart, and showing your bait in certain ways is very important. So the A-rig has a ton of presence, right? Another big bait that I like to throw, if you know me, I love throwing glide baits. This is a TS-10 by Fish Everything. We have some of his G300s in the case behind me here in the swim bait case. What's great about a glide bait is it is able to sit suspend. It's a big presence. You're able to see it very well. You can fish it a lot of different ways, right? So the great thing about this one specifically, it's a big presence. Again, it's not the widest bait out there, but it, you know, it's much wider than something like a chatterbait or a crappie jig. And you're also gonna get a good return on the flat side of the bait because you're not just always looking down the front like this. This bait also does this, and it does this, and it does this. So you're able to track it very, very easily. So starting off, I'm not saying go get a swim bait. I would highly recommend starting off with an A-rig, setting your range out to around 80 foot depth. Keep your bottom content off the very bottom of your screen. That is going to be probably the number one tip I'd give people if you are just starting out. Take an A-rig out there. Just try to find your bait. And another thing, before you even get on the water, make sure you're setting your transducer completely straight on. If it's not completely straight on, you're gonna be looking right and you're gonna be looking like over here and you're like, oh, my bait's like way, way off. So make sure it's straight. That is like probably, other than keeping your foot on the trolling motor, that is probably my number two suggestion. Or I guess that would probably overtake keeping your foot on the trolling motor. It is very important that you are lined up perfectly on there. I personally barrel mount my transducer on the trolling motor barrel where the prop spins. That gives me always 100% straight down the pipe, just because that barrel is going to be pointing exactly where the little head's pointed, right? People that mount it on the shaft, just make sure you're getting it dead on. I think Garmin, the new Garmin Force trolling motors, they have a little slot in there to make sure it's dead straight on as well. So I'm not gonna go into that too much, but presence of baits, this puts off very big presence as well. And I do wanna talk about another one, the jerk bait. We've got plenty behind me. Didn't even bother grabbing one out. Another reason why I love fishing a jerk bait is because I can leave it in one spot. I can look at the fish react, and we'll get into that in different ways. I'm able to leave it there, work it fast, work it slow, and I can do the same with each of these different baits, adding weight to one, taking off weight, putting bigger baits on, putting smaller baits on, and I talked about that in another video. Let's talk about how to present your bait, right? So I'm going to get rid of these arrows here. We're going to move Mr. Fish forward on this brush pile. So this is one scenario I find quite a bit here. Let's draw our brush pile. You know, we got trees and limbs hanging off of it. And let's draw Mr. Fishy just, you know, chilling around the brush pile looking all happy like. This is probably one of the biggest mistakes I see people do. And let's just imagine there's another fish right here. It's one of the biggest mistakes I see early live scopers do. Let's take pink here. Pink's gonna be our bait. A lot of people will try to hit that fish directly on the head. They will throw in front of it in this range here. Why would you do that? You're only bringing your bait closer to you. There's a couple baits out there like the Jackal Counterback Spoon that actually run away from you. Most baits will always come towards you. So a lot of people will throw their bait in front of that fish. It's gonna sink down and they're, you know, they're wondering why that fish isn't seeing it perhaps. Well, fish don't always look towards you. A lot of the time they look away from you or they're looking to the side. So putting that bait in the position to where it can only be seen one way is not the way to do it, right? And we'll talk more about some of that. What you should be doing with your baits. Let's assume this is 80 feet out. I like to cast around 5 to 10 foot past that fish to ensure that fish is not running that way. It could be running this way. It could be going up that way. It could go any different way. It's a fish. It can swim, go anywhere it wants. But if I am dropping my bait 10 foot, 5 foot behind that fish, depending on the sink rate, I am able to count it down, I'm able to watch my bait go down, and I can present my bait around the fish's zone. And if you don't already know, a fish, let's draw a stupid looking fish here, its eyes are on the top of its head. Let's draw a little smiley face. Its eyes are on the top of its head, so it is seeing what is directly above it, and it is seeing kind of downish. So this whole range here is visual visually going to be what a bass sees. And I think scientists have said that they can even see a little farther behind them. But like I said, if you're only presenting it to them one way and it's only going towards you, more than likely they might see it, but it's not going to be in that zone long enough for them to really check it out and be interested in it. I have caught tons of fish where I throw it, I say, in front of them towards the boat, and they have eaten it, but it is not the most effective. If you're able to drop it behind that fish and reel it over their heads, and that's my second key point here, reel it over their head, that is the way to do it. I know Josh Jones has done some stuff, Milliken's shown some stuff on this. Never let that bait fall below the fish. Don't hit this zone. If you're going for this fish up top, do not hit that zone below the fish. Of course, it's not in their visual line, but fish actively feeding are gonna be fishing up. So everything is going to be going away from the fish and up. This is how I work my baits. It's always gonna go towards me all the time just based on reeling it in. And it also is only going to go higher and higher and higher once I get that fish to react. And that is something we're gonna talk about at the very end. So bait presentation here. I'm going to cast back here. My bait's gonna sink down and I'm going to reel it pretty level until I get that fish to really start moving on my bait. A lot of the time, if I'm throwing an A-rig, this is exactly what I'm doing. If I'm throwing a swim bait, same thing. If I'm throwing a jerk bait, I'm keeping it above that fish. So whatever bait, let's just go with Megabass here. If I'm throwing a Megabass Vision 110 and it only gets to this level right here, and that fish doesn't react to it ever, I'm gonna go to a Vision 110 plus one, which might get around this level, right above that fish. Another big thing I see people do is try to hit the fish with your lure. That's generally not the best idea. How often do you see bait fish go straight up to a bass and asked to be eaten, right? Doesn't really happen that way. So I always try to maintain a good distance away from that fish. A good point of reference, if I'm throwing a bait that's, let's just call it a jerk bait again. I'm gonna be typically keeping that bait around 2 foot away from that fish. Most of the time they can hear it, most of the time they can see it. If you're fishing really, really dirty water, you might wanna get it closer, like somewhere like JB Thomas, where Brandon Barks is literally dropping a jig on their nose. That's how good he is with active target and keeping on those fish. All right, sorry about that. Had a customer come in here. We're talking about some fishing, so kind of forget where we're at. But essentially what you're gonna be doing, cast farther than that fish is actually sitting. Lead it up to him. Let's just use the A-rig as an example. You know, typically when I tell people to start with live scope, just throw the biggest bait you can. The easiest one to work is probably the A-rig. Then you work your way down to something like a jerk bait eventually, or even a crappie jig, which is Damiki, right? So just throw farther than that fish, sink it down, and try to keep it level. Now this is going to be going more into the fish reaction side of things. So once I get my bait down towards that fish, I'm gonna keep playing this video over and over because it's one of the best videos I've seen, not just with my own eyes, but also on the internet, of a fish truly reacting to my bait. What I'm gonna be doing is going to be dropping that bait and constantly bringing it to that fish until it reacts. There's always a certain distance. I call it, what do I even call it? I don't really call it anything, but there's always a zone around a fish where they can see, where they can feel very effectively. When you get your bait dropped down and into this zone, let's say right here, you're gonna see that fish react. It's gonna perk up, it's going to target that bait. It's gonna go, whoop, there's bait there, I wanna go eat that, right? What I'm gonna be doing from here, now that that fish sees that bait, this is key. This is one of the things that I never go back on. This is something that is cardinally, like, always happens. I am never going to drop that lure down. I'm always gonna bring that lure away from that fish. So my A-rig, that fish sees it here. I'm gonna start bringing it up towards the boat. And depending on the fish's reaction, if it chases faster, I'm gonna speed up my lure. If that fish slows down because it doesn't think it can catch that bait, I might slow it down until it really reacts. And that's the cool thing about Garmin LiveScope, and the cool thing about getting a lot more information is you can see the puffs of water that that fish produces. You can see the disturbance in the water, and that all kind of goes back to your gain, your color limit, how you have that set up. But with really clean water, I didn't bring that A-rig very close to that fish. I'm able to bring it up, and at the very last second, you're gonna see at the very, very last second, you can see me pull that A-rig to really just make that fish react. And in the colder water, you can do that more and more. When it starts getting warmer, it doesn't work as much, but you can see me really pop that bait up about a foot. You can see the disturbance it caused, and you can see that fish really just commit to it. So that is how I am going to make those fish react. And it's all about, it's a give and take. It's all about how you look at the fish and how it's moving, and it's all about how you react after the fact. So you can impart action on a bait, see how the fish reacts, and also react to that reaction to get that bite, hopefully. Now, when I am targeting the fish most of the time, if I'm looking out around 80 foot, which is pretty standard on where I'm looking out, so if this over here is 80 foot, and this over here is 0 foot, I like to really try to get my fish within a zone to where I have a lot of room to work with from the edge of the boat, right? So typically, the fish here, I like to get within around 65 foot. Let's call this right here 65 foot away from the boat. That gives me plenty of time to really go back and get a secondary cast if I need be. Like if I draw this fish in around right here, I'm still able to cast back on it and hopefully get that fish to eat. A lot of the time, if I'm throwing high percentage baits, like a crappie jig or a damiki rig or something like that, I might try for them a little farther out. Now, with the smaller bait, as we talked about, you're going to have a lower and lower percentage on getting that bait within the fish's zone, because we're not just talking two-dimensionally here. We're not just shooting out like a ruler stick and dropping it on that fish like that with LiveScope. You've always got a degree of variance. You have to make sure everything is aligned, not just looking at, oh, I see a mark out here, right? So this is going to be a good example of actually how LiveScope is effective on a single fish, right? So let's just use orange, for example, here. And let's draw two fish. So in terms of the amber color scheme, this fish here is going to be very, very white. So that means I'm looking on it pretty dead on. And a lot of the time, you're not gonna see a physical fish like this. Most of the time, you're going to see something like this. And let's also think about it this way. I got my swim bait here. Let's think of this way. If that fish is broadside, perpendicular to the boat, what are you gonna see? You're gonna see that cone being filled up with a lot of this fish. So it's gonna look like this. I'm looking out at this fish, it's perpendicular. I'm going to see just a big blob out there. I'm gonna see a very non-distinct fish. It's just gonna be kind of a circle. I'll call them flames here and there, because you can still get the height of the fish and you can get a little bit of the depth. It's gonna be a very solid blob, just like that. Now, let's say that fish is looking directly at you, at the camera. There's not that much there. So instead of this big wider blob, it might be something like this, a very skinny blob. And this is something you really, really have to think about here. How is that fish moving? Is it moving perpendicular to the boat? Is it moving at me? Once you get that fish's attention, you're going to notice a shift, hopefully, if that fish is perpendicular. If you get the attention of that fish, it's gonna be turning into this blob. You're gonna see it turn, hopefully, on your forward-facing sonar, especially with an LVS-34 transducer. So that is one thing that I really hound on people. And a lot of the time, too, if you're not directly in that cone angle or that fish is close enough to the boat or far enough away from the boat, it is not probably going to be pure orange like this. You might see a little white streak in the middle like that. And that is what I really like to see. That tells me when that white streak or hot spot appears in that fish, I know I'm perfectly on it. And this is one thing, again, that Garmin does better than anyone, in my opinion, is that you're able to see three-dimensionally. I know it is lined up. If my lure comes down here, and it's gonna be an A-rig, again, for example, my A-rig's coming down, I know it's lined up because there is that white spot in the middle. If I'm off a little bit, it'll probably be colored in a little bit more. So if I'm seeing this example here, as my bait's going down at the very start, you can see my lure is very red, very, very orangey. It's not very bright at all. But as soon as that fish is tracking it, and the closer this gets to the boat, the easier it is to see. It's gonna have that little density mark in the middle, and that fish also has that density mark. So you can really tell a lot about your screen. You can tell a lot about what's going under the water, and that's one of the biggest things about live scope fishing. So another thing too, this goes hand in hand with just simple fish patterning throughout the year. A lot of the time you're gonna hear people talk about, especially on like a ledge lake or something like that. So let's actually just draw up a ledge here for y'all. Just like the situation we have in those previous videos. Got a ledge. A lot of the time you're looking at the ledge, a lot of the time as well, the fish, especially when they're active, they're gonna be sitting above the ledge. They're gonna be looking this way. They're gonna be looking at all the bait fish or whatever, whatnot. A lot of the time they're sitting above the ledge. And this is one of the easier ways to catch them when they're above the ledge, right? So typically your bait fish is gonna be high. They're pushing bait up on that ledge because it is a stopping point for that bait. The bait can't go farther up on that ledge. They're gonna get stuck. And you can translate this to a bank as well. They can push bait up against a bank. So where am I gonna cast? Should be pretty obvious now. I'm gonna cast up here, sink my lures down, wait for them to track it. Bada bing, bada boom, pretty easy. When you get in the situation of them sitting very low, they are not in a feeding mood. They're sitting down here, kind of milling around, doing whatever, sitting near the bottom. It is a lot harder, I will say, to get them to eat. That's when I'm gonna choose a bottom bait, something that gets down towards the bottom. I might not be throwing an A-rig, I might still be throwing an A-rig, kind of just depends. But when you see these fish on the graph like this, typically, I can work a crankbait, get a reaction bite. I can drag a jig. I'm gonna get it down a lot closer to those fish because they are in a negative feeding mood. They don't want to move on a, they don't want to move on a meal. They don't want to go chase a shad or something like that. And this is where your bait preference comes in as well. So typically, the way I think about it is if there is a bigger meal, they are going to be a bigger, slower meal, something like a glide bait. They're going to be more than likely inclined to want to go eat it, especially if you get it closer to them when they're in a negative feeding mood. If they're in a positive feeding mood, if they're sitting up high on the ledge or sitting high on a brush pile, that is when I will keep it away from them. I'm gonna, instead of, this situation, I'm gonna go back to the other one. I'm not gonna get it as close, because like I said, there is always an area around that fish where they can sense the bait. Typically, if it's tough, I'm gonna get it as close as I can with a drop shot, a Ned rig, something like that. If they are in an active feeding mood, they want to go eat something, I'm gonna keep it as far away from them as possible just so I can tap into that natural instinct of, hey, that's a big meal, I wanna go eat it. So I hope this video has really helped you understand the correlation, not just between what you're seeing on your graph, but also really understanding your bait presentation mistakes that you might be doing, and also how your fish are gonna react to the baits. If they're not moving on it, try something bigger, try something smaller, try it faster, try it slower. There's a lot of different things out there. I have narrowed it down pretty well to, you know, keeping an A-rig, a jerk bait, a glide bait, and a Damiki rig on my boat all times of the year, just because I am able to go around, not just look for fish like a lot of the scopers do for the smallmouth tournaments, but also go out and look for fish, just set up on like a ledge like this. You know, if I know they're set up like this, I'm just gonna go lock down, throw a Texas rig, throw a jig, throw something that I can get very close to them. A drop shot's one of my go-tos most of the time when they're tough. But in the wintertime, you know, a lot of them are gonna be set up higher in the water column. They're gonna be very predictable. And I can easily just burn my A-rig or burn my glide bait across their head, and that's how I caught my PB. It was out over like 50 foot of water, just doing absolutely nothing out there. And I just worked my glide bait above its head. It was already up pretty high, so I didn't have to sink it down at all. Really awesome fight. But again, I hope you enjoyed. If you did, please consider subscribing to the Lake Pro Tackle page. I'm giving out a lot of juicy information, not just pertaining to live scope, but pertaining to stuff that we get in store here, how you can utilize it. And I really just want to help y'all out catching fish, because that's what I love doing. I want to make sure that y'all can do the same thing. So again, one last time, hope you enjoyed the video. Leave a like on it. If you did, subscribe to the channel, and we will see you next time at Lake Pro Tackle, guys. See ya.